So the idea is sort of a review what happened in the last decade, you know, this super boom that we enjoyed in our relationship with China, and then talk about the future. You know? I mean, the party is over. So what type of challenges we tend to face? And let me warn you that, as Professor Zhu mentioned before, I'm and the idea is to give you more of a research technical view. It's not going to be an institutional view. So all the controversial arguments are mine, not IDB's. And also I am an economist, so economists usually tend to talk about the problems. You know, it's not for other reasons that they call it the dismal science. So let me start with the outline. So just look at the sort of stylized facts of the last 15 years, 10 years of boom in terms of trade and investment, and then move on to the future. What this end of the boom means, is this a new relationship? What sort of response, what sort of policy response we can expect from Latin America? And here I tried this exercise of thinking, what would be the nightmare response that the region could give in this new scenario, and what could be the dream response? And then I'll conclude. So pretty quickly, Professor Gu already mentioned this facts, and they are well known. This is just the rate of growth of trade, in the last 15 years, growing 35% on average. Then we have the crisis and the recovery, and then we are, clearly going down, to negative growth. I mean, the first semester of 2015, trade fell by nearly 7%. Exports to China fell by 20%. I mean, the only thing that grew was imports from China. But despite all this reversal, our share, the China share of lack trade continues to grow. It's around 13%. What is behind this boom? I mean, it's also well known. Commodities for manufacturing pattern of trade. I mean, we have this growing surplus in mining, agriculture with China, and importing a lot of manufacturing goods. I mean, the deficit in manufacturing goods keep growing even during the crisis. And then we have this very heterogeneous relationship throughout the region. I mean, the ones that really managed to have a sort of a balanced trade with China and enjoying the gains, the export gains of China boom was clearly the ones on the southern cones, and for obvious reasons, not the ones that have the natural resources. And the other ones, especially the ones in Central America, it's basically a one-side trade. I mean, trade is basically imports from China, and that includes Mexico and Central America. So it's hard to generalize when you talk about the region as a whole if you want to really talk about the impacts of this boom. I mean, in terms of investment, it was the reaction was came much later in the game. I mean, almost at the end of the boom. Now we had trade coming first, and then we start seeing, which is sort of an expected pattern. The problem with investment, as we all know, it's the data. You can either use MOFCOM official data, and then you have to use a different scale. You can go to 3 billion a year, for instance, in 2012, or you can use those announced series that you can find out there, which is basically looking at newspapers and collecting all the Chinese announcements. But in either case, I mean, the different scale is brutal. The announced go to up to $20 billion. The one you're talking about, $3 billion. But in any case, there's clearly an uptick in terms of foreign direct investment, Chinese foreign direct investment in the region coming late in the game. In terms of composition of this investment, and here using the announced data, it's not that much different from the composition of trade. I mean, it's heavily, still heavily concentrated in mining and in energy in general, and in agriculture, in natural resources, and it's heavily concentrated on the countries that, of course, have those resources. More impressive than the FDI takeoff has been, this upsurge in what we call policy loans. And this is a series that is collected by the Inter-American Dialogue. It's basically also based on announced. But the amount of loans, which are in most cases are loans in exchange for oil, a lot of the natural resources, has been, pretty much impressive, and has been concentrated, in the Southern Cong, Venezuela, Brazil, Argentina, Ecuador. So we see much more activity there than in FDI. In terms of where this money is going, both FDI and loans, there's clearly a tendency that they're moving into infrastructure. In most cases, are infrastructure related to natural resources. And here's just a couple of projects. Most of them are well known, where there's either FDI or Exim Bank loan to finance those projects. When we look at Latin America FDI in China, it's clearly, very small. We still have to acquire a critical mass. And I think this is part of the discussion I'm going to have with you guys later on in terms of what type of response the region can get. But clearly, it's pretty much Brazil, we have some Chile, but the region is still hasn't awakened for the opportunities that FDI in China can give in terms of growth. So we saw on that graph that the party is over, the boom is over. So what can we expect in terms of the future? So can we expect a new pattern of trade? I think this thing of commodity for manufacturing is over. We're going to have a different thing coming on. Or is this just a strong cyclical adjustment? And it's not a new pattern. We're just going to have this downswing, but it's going to recover pretty fast. My hunch, and I bet very much that this is it's pretty much a cyclical adjustment. I mean, I never believed the idea that the commodity cycles were over. So we are bound to see that. And it doesn't make sense to believe that the downside is going to last forever. This is going to come back pretty soon. As the ambassador has mentioned earlier, if you look at the Chinese imports in terms of volume of natural resources, they keep growing, pretty fast in volumes. I mean, if you strip the price effects, so China suddenly didn't, became sufficient, out-sufficient in natural resources. China is going to keep growing and is going to keep importing a lot of those resources. And the relationship's not going to change that much. I mean, we happen to have those resources, and this is bound to continue to dominate the scenario. But you can also say that the epic days are over for a number of reasons. Some of them, Professor Zhu already commented here. There is this thing with China slowing down. I mean, this was inevitable. I mean, just like the commodity cycle, nobody could believe that China would keep growing at 10-12% forever. It's just, it's not freak economics. I mean, if you just look at the as China accumulates capital, the diminishing return setting. I mean, all this movement from the low productivity sector, agriculture, to the manufacturing is bound to be exhausted. So you're gonna see China growing, you know, a slower rate. It's just put here the IMF forecast, but you know nobody is talking yet about China growing less than 6% or 5%. And again, as the ambassador said, we are talking now a much bigger economy. You know, 5% of a much bigger economy is going to still mean a huge market for raw material, so natural resources in general. So I don't see much of a change there in terms of the pattern of trade. And then, you know, what can we think in terms of policy response from the region. Huh? And I would say that this new scenario, because during the boom, we are selling without making any, you know, big effort. I mean, China was buying everything we could sell. You know, they came after us for the resources we had. And now, I mean, since the party is over, you know, you're not seeing this epic rate of growth. I think there's clearly a need to put more emphasis on policy issues, particularly on trade policy issues, particularly if you wanna, you know, which is something that always been a concern, you know, this idea that we are just exporting raw material to China. I wanted to diversify this trade. I don't think we ever gonna be a major exporter of manufacturing for China. I mean, competitive advantages are, you know, fatal in this case. But I mean, we definitely can see some diversification. And what countries can do, I mean, clearly is to have a very serious conversation with China about trade policy and try to negotiate around the issues that might be preventing the region to add value to those natural resources that we are exporting. So what type of issues I'm talking about? I mean, again, they are well known. I mean, if you look at China tariffs on agriculture, and here I made a number of options using, I mean, weighting the average with China imports from the world and China imports from some of the countries in Latin America. For instance, Argentina imports, the average tariff for agriculture is 17.3%, which is pretty high. So there's a lot of room there to, you know, to negotiate. It's something that it was sort of overlooked during the boom. I mean, some countries did their homework. I mean, Chile, Peru managed to negotiate FTAs, but you know, Brazil, Argentina, the rest of the region do face some pretty steep traditional tariff barriers in the region. So we need more research on the impact of those barriers, and we need more negotiation, you know, about those barriers with China. And it's not just, you know, one-sided. We all know that, you know, the region has been imposing a lot of barriers on Chinese exports, particularly in manufacturing, you know, anti-dumping, and other issues like that. This is another thing that, just to, you know, illustrate the type of challenges we face. For instance, China exempts some of our agriculture exports. They exempt local production from VAT charges. They charge VAT on imports. So if you add tariffs to this VAT, what I'm calling VAT wedge, we are seeing pretty steep, you know, rates of nominal protection. So that seems that was totally overlooked so far, and both in the policy and the research side, and we don't have, you know, enough information to assess the impacts and the opportunities that the region can have. Another aspect of this relationship, I don't think that competitive pressure from China is over, especially hear a lot about that in Brazil after the 40% devaluation. And when you look at the data, you don't see that happening that much. I mean, China's share of U.S. imports, you know, the more open market in the world, yes, it has stabilized, but you don't see free fall. I mean, they're still pretty much having, you know, a very sizable share of you know, of U.S. manufacturing imports, and you don't see Latin America moving that much. There's a recovery here in Mexico, yes, in part because of, you know, the proximity, more than the proximity than price issues. You don't see any recovery in terms of labor-intensive goods, and in the case of Brazil, even with all the devaluation, you know, the fact is that labor cost is still pretty much much more expensive in Brazil than it is in China. I just put a, you know, a example here in terms of hourly compensation between China, Brazil, and Mexico. You know, even with all the devaluation, you're talking about, you know, more than double the cost of labor in Brazil. So we're still going to deal with this pressure, you know, in this new phase of the relationship. So think in terms of scenarios. So what would be the nightmare scenario for the region in terms of lack of response for this new phase of the relationship? Now, I would say, for instance, governments fail to negotiate those type of trade barriers that I just mentioned, and particularly in agriculture. And in terms of the pressure, they would resort to protectionism, to subsidies, and you know, all in the name of trying to stop the industrialization. And by doing that, they're just going to delay an adjustment that is inevitable. You know, there's no way, you know, you're going to maintain the productivity structure that you have before China, you know, other Asian countries enter the world economy. Another thing is, another point of this nightmare scenario will be, you know, the private sector, you know, instead of fighting, because it's not just an issue of the public sector. No? There's a lot of how the private sector reacts to those new conditions. And if things go bad, you see then, you know, instead of fighting for market access, instead of, you know, trying to understand, you know, how to increase their penetration, especially of more sophisticated goods in the Chinese market, then I'm going to keep lobbying the government for protection, you know, and keep being happy with just the rents that they get by exporting the most basic goods. And China, you know, will be, you know, the worst reaction for us, that China would push, for instance, for this so-called soil to shop. You know, this idea that, you know, they would control the whole supply chain of natural resources, with obvious implications in terms of trade, in terms of transfer pricing, and so on and so forth. In terms of capital flows, I think that there's some important issues here. I mean, in a nightmare scenario, we would still see China FDI, Chinese FDI, very much concentrated on state companies, very much concentrated on natural resources. No? What we would like to see is this investment diversifying towards more, you know, value-added goods, towards more manufacturing, because this would help. At, you know, this ultimately would help our diversification to diversify our trade with China, and also we would still see this very negligible FDI, lack FDI in China, with firms clearly failing to take advantage of, you know, trying to jump the tariffs or the barriers that still exist in the Chinese market, and take the advantage of being close to the client, given the you know, the important cultural difference that exists between the two economies. And finally, we would see, for instance, and that's pretty much on us, you know, if you see some of the economies in the region insisting in very risky macroeconomic policies that could quickly lead us to, you know, balance of payment crisis and things of the like, we could see China, you know, take advantage of this situation and insisting with this kind of, you know, money for oil, loan for oil, infrastructure deals, which, you know, it could be very opaque in some cases. There's not much transparency for the countries as a whole. And of course, now this could be, could lead to, a financial dependence, like being financially dependent from China for the wrong reasons. We want to see, Chinese investment coming and money flowing, but not because we are very vulnerable on the macroeconomic point of view. So what would be the best scenario then? I think it's very much symmetric to that. Yeah? There's no reason why we should move into this nightmare scenario. If the governments respond in a different ways and make a different set of choices. For instance, if they get the macroeconomic right, the macro fiscal positions right, they clearly can have a more beneficial and serious negotiation, and especially trade policy negotiation with China. And along the lines that what we want is trade, what we want is market access. We don't want aids. We want, the ability to be able to sell goods in the Chinese market, and then vice versa. And we also see, in terms of investment, we would see, for instance, Chinese FDI coming to the region led by the private sector, diversifying into manufacturing, services, and of course, respecting the local environmental and competition safeguards. And finally, we would see Chinese financing continues to flow in the region, in a more transparent and market-led conditions, moving away from badly managed conditions. We don't want to see China sustaining bad policies in the region. So just to conclude, it's obvious that the boom was very beneficial for both economies in the region, but it was very much market-led, and during the boom, I think a number of more structural issues, and more structural policy issues were overlooked, which I think it's important to be addressed in this more, sober scenario. We want to, address issues both on the trade flows, on the financial flows and the FDI flows. We do think that if we address those obstacles, there are, yes, opportunities to diversify, to add value to this trade. Still is going to be, in terms of our exports, still is going to be around natural resources. I say I have no illusions about that. But I do see, given the size of barriers they still face, that there are a lot of opportunities there, to add value and to sophisticate the kinds of exports we send to China. I will leave it there. Thank you very much.